Good morning, everybody. My name is Mark Benthian. Welcome to the next presentation of the Earthquake Country Alliance Safer at Home webinar series. Today's topic is Step 7, Reconnect and Restore. Again, my name is Mark Benthian. I'm the Director for Communication, Education, and Outreach at the Southern California Earthquake Center at USC. I'm also the Executive Director of the Earthquake Country Alliance. ECA is a partnership of many public, private, and grassroots leaders and organizations and communities across California. Everyone can join our mailing list to get updates about future webinars and other activities at the address shown on the screen, earthquakecountry.org/alliance. Oh, I'm sorry, I haven't started sharing my screen yet. That would be helpful here. Let me do that. All right. Let me come back and just show the instructions again that I had on the slide. There's the Q&A and the chat function if you've just joined also to interact with us. Q&A is to post questions to the panelists, and then we'll ask those after each presenter is done speaking. You can use the chat as people are doing to communicate with all of us. And again, select the panelists and attendees so your message goes to everyone. And also the live transcript function to see subtitles. You can either see it as a subtitle that plays on your screen or as a full transcript running along the site. So you have some options there. All right. ECA's main way of organizing our content for what to do before, during, and after is the 7 steps to earthquake safety. And our webinar series has been following each of these steps. There was really simple actions to improve safety before, during, and after earthquakes. And you can learn all about these steps at earthquakecountry.org/7steps and in Spanish at terremotos.org/7pasos. Our team for today is really a set of great presenters, and so we'll be introducing them as they do their presentation. If you've just joined, I'm Mark Benthian, the Executive Director of the Earthquake Country Alliance, and lead the Communication Education Outreach Program for the Southern California Earthquake Center at USC. Again, please use the Q&A feature for your questions, and those will be monitored, and as well as the chat, by Jason Ballman and Sharon Sandow de Groot from the Southern California Earthquake Center as we go throughout the day. Here's our agenda. So this is the introduction. We'll be hearing first about key actions during the first days after an earthquake, and then guidance for the first weeks after an earthquake, and then a presentation on stress and renewal and really that long-term kind of how we deal with disasters and manage them, deal with them, react. And it's going to be a great presentation. Looking forward for you to have that today. It really is kind of not just maybe for earthquakes, but for all that we're dealing with right now. So first, we're going to hear from Jeffrey Snoddy, who's the Emergency Services Manager for the City of Torrance Fire Department. Also is our Communications Coordinator for Earthquake Country Alliance, Southern California. So Jeffrey, we're going to turn it over to you. Go ahead, turn your camera and mic on.
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. As you said, my name is Jeffrey Snoddy. I am the Emergency Services Manager for the City of Torrance. My background is in earthquakes. I was a coordinator back in 2006 when I experienced my first earthquake. It was in Hawaii. 6.1 is very frightening, but thanks to training and understanding what the steps were after the 6 steps, I knew how to prepare not only my command, but also my family on how to respond in the days after that. The first thing that should really be on anyone's mind is always put your family and your pets first. Not to the point where you're going into the building to rescue them in a damaged building, but understand that goods, jewelry, material objects are not that important when it comes to your family, when it comes to your life, when it comes to your pet. So ensure that your family and your pets are safe first. And that means have a plan to act after the actual incident days after, so you can sustain yourself after the event. Next, please. After the Ridgecrest incident, the aftershocks were amazing. The biggest one registered as a 5.4, which would be a normal earthquake in any other location. So be aware that in an earthquake, after the initial incident, in the days following, there are going to be a lot of shaking going on, and the building that you evacuated may still be in danger of collapsing. So that goes to the second point, is ensuring that you do not enter buildings that have been damaged days after until they've been inspected, cleared. And ensure that you have earthquake insurance if possible, if you're in a earthquake capable location like California, especially. Ensure you have that type of coverage to ensure that not only are your goods, but the building itself is insured.
Jeffrey, if I can interrupt, I know that because where you are at, you're required to wear the mask. It is having a lot of interference. I don't know if you can pull it further out. I think because it's having your microphone being very, can the microphone be on the outside of your mask?
Okay.
So it's not right next to your mouth, so you're not right on it. That may be the solution.
How's that? Is that better?
It is. It's a little quieter, but it's not having that issue.
Okay, excellent. I'll talk a bit louder. Thank you for your patience with this. It's required to wear a mask in the city and building. So
it's much better though now. Thank you.
Excellent. All right, just to reiterate that you really should have earthquake insurance if you are in a location where earthquakes are a danger. Next, please. So one of the parts of being ready, being prepared, and those days afterwards is ensure you have those types of situations where you can be warned and continue to be warned after the earthquake has occurred. These apps, MyShake, Shake Alert, Quake Alert, these are all based on shakealert.org. And these are things that will actually tell you where the earthquake is, what danger, and also they have some tabs that tell you how to prepare for an earthquake and resources after that. WEAS and Google Android OAS will also provide assistance. The WEA is like an FCC entity that actually allows presidential alerts, disaster alerts, amber alerts to go out to entire locations as a geofence for the disaster. Next, please. So as I discussed before, aftershocks are a true danger, especially after a large event. So when you're in a building, in a shelter, and an aftershock does occur, it's very important that you do not try to run or you don't go to other rooms during the shaking. And especially do not stand in the doorways. There has been some thought on the triangle method and staying in doorways as the door frame is the strongest part of the building, but that's not true. What you want to do is drop, cover, and hold on as per instructions, as per your immediate actions for the actual earthquake itself. Next, please. Exactly. So as you know, if an earthquake does occur and you do have to drop, cover, and hold on, and there isn't anything to drop under, there are also many other ways to protect yourself. You can go next to a wall and drop, cover, or drop and hold on next to the wall. If you're handicapped, you know, in a wheelchair, you just hold on to the wheelchair. If you're in a beach, if you're in a theater, Earthquake Alliance has all these methods on how to protect yourself in the event of an earthquake. Please visit that site to understand all the methods to protect yourself in a variety of situations that aren't typical with a table and something to go under. Next, please.
Jeffrey, there is a typo. There's only one S there before step five. I put that correct link in the chat.
Okay, thank you.
That was my typo. Sorry about that.
Roger that. Next, please. So as discussed in the previous steps, you created a plan with your family and relatives. The whole idea now is to act upon that plan. Ensure that plan is sustainable for at least 3 to 5 days. Have a rally point where you can meet your family members and discuss that plan together, because this is a very dynamic situation and you can't statically plan. and make sure that information that you have as far as contact information is still valid due to the fact after the event, phones may be lost, phones may lose their charge because in some locations there may not be an ability to charge your phone. So try to find a third and second, a third and fourth way to find out how to contact each other, whether it's through your partner's phone, whether it's through going to an actual like a Red Cross site. Understand that you have to stay in contact and work on that plan. Next, please. So return to your home as soon as it's safe, meaning that when you're allowed to go, when the police and law enforcement say you're allowed and the building inspector say you're allowed to go into your building, then into the building, don't try to make that assumption yourself to say that it looks safe. You know, the greatest shaking has stopped. I feel free to go in. Do not do that. Take pictures of the damage. Take pictures of the damage after the initial, after a large aftershock to continue documenting the damage to your location. This will be very important for your insurance when you do try to do an insurance claim. Definitely contact your insurance provider as soon as possible. Have them on the line and tell them your situation and keep documenting what's going on. And also talk to your claims department. There should be a local assistance center set up by the city to where they'll have insurance companies, gas companies, all these businesses to where you can actually not only make claims, but also discuss your gas, your electric, and things like that. So the whole idea is to understand what your local area allows and what your local area can provide to you. And also understanding this overall, in case this happened like in the next few months, that there is a COVID situation, a COVID angle to all this. And so everything has to be socially distanced and there may not be an ability for you to even be in a shelter. You may have to shelter in your vehicle. So understand that and build that into your plan as well. Next, please. So definitely wait to clean and keep all your receipts that you buy. So if you do go, it's almost like a crime scene nearly. So if you do actually start sweeping up the broken glass and putting things back on the wall after you're clear to go through, you're going to contaminate your claim, your insurance claim. So wait to clean, keep all your receipts, and don't touch anything until your insurance adjuster comes in and actually makes that that look around. And also get in writing from your insurance company before you contact anyone. There's going to be a lot of people who may try to take advantage of the situation and may not be reputable or even legal. So make sure that you get your insurance company to sign off on the person that you're hiring to do the damage repair on your building. And definitely watch out for a scam artist. I put in my own city alert, but make sure that you know your own local city alert system. Make sure you know how your city does that call to action. Make sure you know how your city tells you to go to a shelter. Make sure you know how your city gives you warnings. Make sure you know how your city gives you the resources that you need after this type of event and the days after. Next, please.
Jeffrey, before you continue, this is Mark again. For those of you who have joined and for everyone, just a reminder that you can put questions to Jeffrey, put those into the Q&A feature. And we'll be having a Q&A session just when Jeffrey completes.
Excellent. Okay, and also next, please. Our next talker, I believe, is American Red Cross. So American Red Cross has a great deal of resources for people not only at the event, but after the event. So make sure you know how to contact your local Red Cross, and next please, and your local Salvation Army. These are two great resources, local resources that will provide you, sometimes regional resources, that will provide you assistance after the fact for those first 2 to 3 days where you're a bit unstable, where you're just recovering from the incident and you need something to hold you up a bit. Next please. Another local resource that your city should have are things called area disaster centers, or I said LECs, local assistance centers. These are points to where the communications from the city is given to the residents and also for volunteer check-ins. This is a very important part of any city because it gives that city that connection to recover quickly and also information so they know exactly what the city is doing to return the city back to normal. Next, please. Local resources, again, are city shelters. You should know where your city shelters are. You should know the capability the location. You should know what they offer and how to get to it. So that's about it for me. The biggest thing I would like to, for you to take away is one, make sure you don't corrupt the scene of your building to where it's been damaged. Just keep it where it is, localized, and don't touch anything until the adjusters come and take a look at it and record it. And also understand that this is a COVID environment and there's going to be some changes in the way that you would normally do sheltering or then normally the way you would actually recover after an earthquake. There's social distancing issues that are at play here. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Jeffrey, for sharing with us what to really, you know, start doing the first few days after an earthquake, reminding about the aftershocks, which can always send us back to, you know, what to do to protect yourself during an earthquake, and then reset the clock effectively. And then if it's a large enough aftershock, you may need to start doing these activities over again. And Sharon, do we have any questions for Jeffrey?
We do. Cammy asks, I am confused about how a scam artist will take advantage of these emergencies. Could you explain a bit more about that?
Most certainly. For someone to actually work on a building of this type or some kind of a building work, they have to be licensed. So if you have an unlicensed person working on a situation that requires insurance to reimburse, then you won't be reimbursed. And when something like this, a tragedy happens, there are people in the woodwork that do come out and do try to take advantage of a disaster, people who are very vulnerable in that moment, and they'll offer services that they don't actually have, or they'll really inflate the price. For instance, when I was in Hawaii, we had that earthquake, we lost power. What we needed was batteries, and people were selling batteries individually out of a six-pack packet for $5 a battery. These kind of situations are very common because this is a situation where that can be taken advantage of because people are in need and they'll do essentially, they'll reach out for the first hand that comes out. So the whole idea is to make sure that the person is licensed and make sure that person is accepted through your insurance company. So make sure you have a good line, a good contact number for your insurance company and tell them what you're doing and have them clear that hopefully licensed contractor to do work. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a question from Nancy. To communicate better, should more of us get radios, GMRS, FRS, ham radios?
I would say yes. FRS radios are very good for family planning because that range is about optimally like a mile and a half for FRS radios. Ham radios, you need to be licensed for that. So I would say for family planning, I would definitely have FRS radios inside of your kit. So even if your actual phone goes down, AAA batteries or AA batteries in an FRS radio will last for a very long time. For ham radios, of course, there's training. So if you want to have a ham radio in your set, I'd recommend getting training now to get at least to like a technician, lowest level, and then work with that and also coordinate with your local amateur radio group to expand your actual coverage and information. Thank you.
Thank you. We also have a question from Barbara. She asks how to find out if a contractor is licensed.
They can provide their number, but I would definitely work with your insurance company before you hire anyone. Just call the insurance company and have them approve it. Don't put the onus of that on you. Put it on the insurance company. That way they can't turn you down for any insurance claims for unauthorized work.
Great, thank you. And I have a question for Mark from Ann. There were several Shake Alert apps. Do we need to sign up for all of them or is one good enough?
You don't need to have all of them. Some have different regions that they serve. So for example, the MyShake app, which you can get from either the Apple or Google App Store, is statewide. There is an app called Shake Alert LA that is only, it's from LA City, but it works for all of LA County. And they're really pulling from the same data source, the US Geological Survey, Shake Alert, West Coast Earthquake Early Warning System is providing the base signal that's kind of that the each of the apps are powered by that Shake Alert system. There's also Quake Alert and these are kind of ways to get messaging to your phone. You may also get it, as Jeffrey mentioned, as a wireless emergency alert, kind of a like an Amber Alert. And you may also, if you have an Android phone, it may have it built in or soon to where you'll get alerts. So there'll be a variety of ways. You may not always get the alerts because you're not in the region where they're going to be sent to. Either you're too far away from the earthquake and the intensity will be so low that it won't be really needed for you to be alerted, or you may get it after because you're so close to the earthquake that the shaking got to you first before the alert got to you. So it's not a always, you won't always get the alerts for every earthquake, and they only go out for a certain size, like a magnitude 4.5 and above. And then you have to be in an area that they consider that will the shaking intensity would be sufficient to where you really need to take action. And then as soon as you get the alert, you want to drop, cover, and hold on to protect yourself.
Great. Yeah, so, thank you.
Thank you.
That's it for questions.
All right. Thank you, Jeffrey, again, and Sharon for moderating the Q&A. Our next presenter is Candace Powell, Disaster Program Manager with the American Red Cross of Southern California, based in San Diego. Candace.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for paying attention to this very important topic. So as you know, I'm to talk about the first weeks after an earthquake. These are certainly a time of transition. Although those aftershocks are still continuing, we're now going to work toward getting our life, our home, our family, and our routines back in order. If you're able to stay at home, our message is to be prepared to be self-sufficient. If your home is safe to occupy, that it's not in danger of collapsing from aftershocks, you may want to consider whether it's best to stay at home, even if those utilities are out, as shelters or other housing may be overcrowded or not an option, but we want to make sure that you're self-sufficient if it's safe to stay. So that means your emergency supplies kit should be able to supply your family and your pets for the minimum of 3 days and best up to 2 weeks. You may want to consider that there's a lack of running water. There may be utilities shut off. As Jeffrey mentioned, the telephones and communications, we need those alternative messages, ways to communicate, because the electricity, we may not be able to charge our batteries. There may not be internet as well. So very important to think it through, and how can my family be best prepared? The next thing we want to make sure is we're connecting to our family and friends after the earthquake. Let them know you're okay. After the Red Cross, as Jeffrey mentioned, operates a safe and well website that you can register online at redcross.org. And after a disaster, we will post that website and you can sign up to let your loved one know you are safe and well. We also encourage that you would check on your neighbors, the elderly, folks with disabilities. We want to make sure we are checking on those who may be more vulnerable. You will have a variety of tasks to accomplish, mainly if you're staying at home. If your gas was turned off, you will need to arrange with the gas company to turn it back on. if the electricity power went off and then it comes back on, we want to make sure you check your appliances, your electronic equipment, be sure to look for any kind of damage. One thing you learned in a previous step from this series is be careful when you're entering your home. If things were not secured and you open a cupboard, be careful for falling objects. We just want everybody safe. If the water lines were broken, we are also checking for that water damage. As Jeffrey mentioned, we are also at this point gathering all those important documents that might have been misplaced, damaged, or destroyed. If we've done our preparation and have our emergency go kit, then we have copies of our ID, all of our insurances, our emergency contact information, and even some electronic backup of all of your documents. Also important in that kit might be photos of your contents of your home prior to the earthquake. So that's if we're staying at home. Next slide. If we are unable to stay at home, at this point, we've listened to our emergency responders, our county alert system. Again, cannot stress enough, as Jeffrey mentioned, and now is the time to sign up for those alerts so that you can get them automatically. But if it's unsafe to stay at home, or if there are threats of fire, or there's a hazard, we may need to evacuate. There are several options for evacuation. You know, we'd like to strongly consider your own family needs. If it's possible to stay with family or friends, it's good to check out with your insurance to see if perhaps staying at a hotel or renting another place to stay would be covered by the insurance. And then a final option would be the temporary emergency shelters that I'll talk a little bit about. We might want to consider that emergency shelters are communal living. They're usually set up, as you can see in the photo there, in a large space. During COVID, we expand that space a little bit, but it is still communal living. So if your utilities are turned off and your home is still safe, you may want to consider staying at home, or as I said, with family and friends. If you do evacuate, we strongly recommend that you do tell your neighbors and families that you will be away. If the shelter is your choice, it's important to know that shelters are run in a number of different ways. They're almost always supported by volunteers, but they can be managed by the city, by a county, by different community partner agencies, or the American Red Cross. So they can be managed by different organizations. I'll talk a little bit about what a Red Cross shelter would look like. We operate our shelters at the request and with the collaboration of the affected city or county. So we don't just go and set up. We usually are working with the county Office of Emergency Services or the city, and they determine together where's a safe place to operate the shelter, and then we would set up the shelter. If at a Red Cross shelter, you'll be provided a cot, a blanket, a comfort kit, water and snacks are provided, and 3 meals a day. We have Red Cross volunteers who are available to provide health services. We also provide mental health counseling. We provide disaster spiritual care and also caseworkers who can assist with recovery planning. You may be wondering, what do I take when I'm evacuating? Very important to remember that our medications are important to make sure you're taking all that you need. If you have medical equipment such as diabetes monitoring and supplies, or a walker, a cane, breathing machines, please make sure to bring your medical equipment. You may want to bring pillow, blanket, a sleeping pad, a change of clothing. If there are infants, babies, please bring diapers, food, formula. And then if there are small children, perhaps some comfort items or, you know, their little teddy bear. And then most importantly, those documents. So you're going to want to have all of that in your go kit. What not to take to shelters, what not to bring. First and foremost is large quantities of anything, whether that's clothing, food, or personal items. As you can see from the picture, usually your items need to fit, underneath that cot or near that cot. So it's not a place to bring everything. You also would not want to bring your valuables and bring them into the shelter. As we said, it's a wide open space. So you want to make sure those are safely out of the shelter or locked away. And then the final point I want to make here is about pets. We know many people will not evacuate without their pets, rightly so. Service animals for folks with disabilities are permitted inside a Red Cross shelter. Non-service animals, what will happen with the Red Cross is we will partner with the community animal shelters or animal services and partner with them to operate an emergency pet shelter. It would either be collated very near the shelter on perhaps the same grounds or nearby. So for an emergency pet shelter, we often will have the local Humane Society help us set up and manage an emergency pet shelter. Large animals, and I'm talking horses and, you know, big animals, those are typically housed at animal shelters offsite. So in San Diego, we have used perhaps the fairgrounds or large facilities to house the horses. One last point about pets is to remember they need an emergency kit as well. In their emergency kit, we want to include food, water, their medication, leashes, and always a safe container or pet carrier so that they can be housed safely in the carrier. Okay, next slide. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about our recovery processes and the resources that are available for you. As soon as possible after the earthquake or the disaster, it's important to set up an alternative mailing address. This can be done at the post office. Often the post office may, so that you have a different way to change your address and it goes directly to a PO box. Or you can do that either in person or online. So it's important, we often think, forget about that, but we need to be able to continue to receive our mail. The insurance process, as Jeffrey talked about, it's important to contact your insurance right away. to begin the claims process. Hopefully we've got all our contact information, our policy numbers, all of that in our emergency go kit, and your photos as well. Very, very handy at this point. As Jeffrey talked about, you might also want to begin to take those photos of the damage that was done, but listening to the insurance agent. I can't stress enough, all of us here on the presentation can't stress enough that you've checked out your insurance coverage ahead of any disaster. Is it homeowners insurance? Do you have renters insurance? Do you have earthquake coverage in a separate policy? Need to check whether your flood insurance will cover tsunami. You need to know whether you have coverage for contents, for structure damage, and for living expenses. There is an excellent nonprofit resource that I'd like to mention here who does insurance advocacy and also education. It is called United Policy Holders. So their web address would be www.unitedpolicyholders. Excellent program. You can sign up for workshops on insurance, and they are great partners after a disaster to help understand that whole insurance process. Next, I'm going to talk about some financial assistance programs that would be available from our government. So I'm going to take it program by program a little bit. Would encourage that you visit disasterassistance.gov as it's listed on the screen. And in that, at that website, you will learn about financial assistance programs from the Federal Emergency Management Agency. We know it as FEMA. This is how we can enter and find out all of the programs for FEMA. Also, the Small Business Association, and they list a whole number of federal, state, and local agencies. So I want to talk about FEMA for a bit. FEMA assistance is available after a disaster once a presidential declaration has been issued. It's sort of a misunderstanding that FEMA is always available, but it is not. It is after the presidential declaration is issued. Sometimes that takes a while to get declared, if at all. But once FEMA is available and activated, the program that we have found most valuable is called Individuals and Household Assistance Program. Don't have to remember all this. It's on that website, disaster.gov. But what they do offer are home repair grants, cash grants to repair your home. It can be about $26,000, but it is a grant available once you go through the application process and through all the ID and proof of damage. A second program under FEMA is called Housing Assistance, and this program can be made available for that short-term lodging, perhaps at a hotel or even rental assistance for as long as 18 months to help you through that recovery and repair process. If there are, in some cases where there is so much damage done by the disaster that housing is at short supply, then another program that FEMA would offer or may offer is mobile homes for temporary housing. I will let you know that the FEMA application process is a bit complicated and cumbersome. It requires a great deal of diligence. However, it is we have found that if there are long-term disaster casework programs, they are experts at being able to help get through the FEMA application process. And Red Cross caseworkers have assisted with many in the past. So that's at the federal level. I want to talk a little bit about state assistance. There are state programs that's usually provided through the county or city recovery efforts, but they tend to provide grants for the community to help with debris removal, with hazard mitigation. And these are usually through the CalEMA, California Emergency Management Agency. City and counties, as Jeffrey mentioned, will also open local assistance centers. And what I liken this to is sort of a one-stop shopping center where all of the insurance, or no, I shouldn't say all, but a lot of the insurance, a lot of the businesses, the county agencies, the nonprofit agencies that would be there to help families through these difficult weeks, they're in one place. So usually the Red Cross is there. And what we'll do is meet with the families, kind of hear what their needs are, and then put a roadmap together. And if they need a permit or if they need different replacing of their documents, we can guide them through the local assistance center to get all of their needs met in just sort of one visit. Two other recovery resources I want to mention, of course, is the Red Cross. Many times after disasters, we will work with families, open cases, provide casework and recovery planning, and if resources allow, financial assistance. And then one last program I want to mention is called VOAD, which stands for Voluntary Organizations After Disasters. This is a national organization, but they tend to have local chapters, I guess. I just left the San Diego VOAD meeting to join this presentation, but VOAD stands for Voluntary Organizations Active in Disasters. And it is in San Diego, has been meeting since 2003. And it is ready and prepared with volunteers and nonprofit agencies, other faith-based disaster programs such as the Salvation Army or the United Methodist or the Southern Baptist. Long-term disaster casework programs are there, and they meet and they are ready to go into action when there is a disaster. And they tend to focus on recovery for those who are underinsured or uninsured, but they're a great resource. And then one final thing I wanted to mention is, we've already kind of covered it, is the Contractor State Licensing Board ensured that if you are making repairs, that you check out that your insurance as well as the website. Okay, Mark, that would be it for me.
Thank you very much, Candace. Tons of great information. And as has been maybe put in the chat and question, the presentation and the recording of today's presentation will be online on the earthquakecountry.org/safer-at-home website by early next week. So be looking for that. And Sharon, do we have any questions now for Candace?
We do. Philip asked if you could please repeat the Red Cross registration site name again, please, the Safe and Well.
Yes, it's called Safe and Well, and you can find it through the redcross.org. And please note that it's not like a live every day, it's after a disaster. So if we were to have an earthquake tomorrow, and we would post that website.
The link is recently added to the chat, so everybody can see that link in the chat as well.
Great. We have a question from Gloria. How far in advance do we need to be available for assisting others, for volunteering? So I guess the difference between being a disaster volunteer and a spontaneous volunteer.
Well, the Red Cross, thank you. Red Cross really is all about volunteers. 90% of the support we give is through our volunteers. And so we are open for volunteers on a daily basis. We highly recommend that, you know, when it is calm and there are no disasters, that's when to get involved. We can best support you and best train you to be active so that, you know, we often have to respond within a couple hours. So it's really tough to take volunteers off the street and get them ready to go in a couple hours. So it's best to sign up now. And you can do that at redcross.org as a volunteer.
We do have one other question. If you're staying in a shelter and you use a CPAP machine, would there be an outlet for using such a machine or other type of device next to your cot?
Yeah, so one of the things our health service team would do, we have a nurse basically at the shelter at all times, and what they would do is make sure that access to electricity is met, and if we could not do that at a shelter, then we would look at, are there alternatives like placing in a hotel where we could find electricity?
Thank you.
Thanks again, Candace. Now,
thank you, everyone.
So just as an introduction, Nick Arnett wears many hats, and I'll let you kind of say a little bit more about yourself, Nick, but we're really thankful for you joining us today on a very important topic of what people face after any disaster in terms of how they're handling all the stress and the situation of that. And you have a really nice presentation about how to manage that. So I'll turn it over to you.
All righty. So I do not have a full-time job, although it's been a lot like full-time because I do work for the U.S. Forest Service. And it has been pretty much full-time since the beginning of August. I was out on wildfires until just a few days ago. Happy to be home. And I think I'm staying home, although I know down in San Diego, you've got some fire weather going on. I also do a lot of different things. So I write books and I teach CERT. I notice we have some CERT people, that's Community Emergency Response Team, who are here. So welcome to you. Candace mentioned VOAD. I've been on the board of directors of our VOAD here in Santa Clara County, and I am currently co-chair of the Emotional Spiritual Committee addressing COVID-19 up here in the Bay Area. But for about 15 years, where my heart mainly is doing crisis intervention and teaching resilience. I'm also a fire chaplain. And I have a book coming out next year called Stress into Strength. And that really is about what you see in the title there, about how stress and renewal equals resilience. So if you only take away one thing from this, it's that stress doesn't have to be bad for you. It's kind of like going to the gym. Going to the gym is stressful. It'll only hurt you if you do it for too long. You don't take the proper breaks between sets, between workouts, if you don't get enough sleep, nutrition, and so forth. If you lift too much, you can get hurt. But stress is a lot like just working out at the gym. So there are a lot of definitions of stress. And here's a simple one. I guess there's a lot of confusion about what stress is. In fact, it's confusing because we use the word to mean both the thing that causes the stress and our reaction to it. Here's my really simple definition. Stress is when your heart beats faster. So I want you to notice there were a lot of things that are not negative that caused that stress reaction. because stress helps us take on challenges, rise to opportunities, and deal with threats as well. We tend to, our brains have this thing called a negative bias, where we tend to focus and react much more to negative information. And of course, news media and advertising and social media takes big advantage of that. But the negative bias around stress is this idea that it's bad for you, but it isn't. It amazingly, people who don't believe stress is bad for your health, even though they report really high levels of stress, actually live longer than people who believe stress is bad for you. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. And the big difference is that those folks are very often doing things that trigger what I like to call renewal. So we talk about stress hormones like adrenaline and cortisol, and we talk about the damage they do to your system. Well, your body has another whole system with associated hormones and so forth, which actually not only repairs all the damage that stress does, if you activate it, but it also helps you grow and become stronger even. So that's the big missing piece here. All this negative talk about stress tends to leave out the idea of renewal, which is just as much of a part of us as stress is. And the fact is that resilience comes from both stress and renewal. Again, just like going to the gym, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. But if you get the right kinds of stress and the right amounts of stress, and the right kinds, the right amounts of renewal at the right intervals, sort of the right rhythm, you actually can build up your strength and resilience. So what's renewal, this thing I'm talking about? It's those things that really slow down your heartbeat, which we all kind of need to be more intentional about. Stress reactions happen automatically. Kind of have to plan and be intentional about activating renewal. So, short version of things that activate renewal: connection, especially caring connections, commitment, really being committed to showing up, being present, and experiences. And that's one of the tricky ones, because even though I write books about how to turn stress into strength and other things, and I'll have some links to the books later on, the part of your brain that you need to settle down, which is sometimes called the monkey mind, it only learns through experience. You really don't get much of this through books. You have to give yourself experiences that kind of slow down the heart rate and activate renewal. So a lot of this is about becoming more flexible. And if there's one thing we need after an earthquake hits or any other natural disaster, it's to become a lot more flexible, because the ways we did things before, like the very buildings we live in, no longer may be there. So I've had two big earthquakes impact me quite a bit. One was 1989 here in the Bay Area. I was here for it. I was in a building on rollers, and that was quite a ride. I was underneath my business partner's desk and really grateful that he had a big, heavy oak desk. And then 10 years ago, I deployed with a medical team to Port-au-Prince, Haiti, after the big earthquake there, doing both medical work and the psychological and spiritual response. And the incredible stress of a quarter of a million deaths in an area that only has about 8 million people. So a lot of people had big losses, plus the loss of homes and so forth. So to build this flexibility, we actually need to do things like going to the gym, taking on those opportunities and challenges, and even facing up to threats, because those are going to happen, raising the heart rate, and then connection, commitment, and experience to slow the heart rate. And it's the two of them together that make us stronger and more resilient. So I'm going to talk about those in three dimensions: physical, social, and spiritual. So you've probably heard of the way we talk about physical stress and renewal. Well, especially the stress part, because again, our negative bias tends to make us focus on that. It's called fight or flight. There's a psychologist that came up with that about 100 years ago. What a lot of people don't realize is that same guy came up with this phrase, rest and digest, to talk about what our brain and our body do in response to heal and grow after fight or flight is activated. And that gives us this physical strength for doing things, including things like muscle memory and so forth. But again, like the gym, you go, you have the stress of working out, but by doing it at the right rhythm, by working out on the right schedule, getting your sleep and rest and protein and so forth, you build up strength. So what's going on physically is you have those stress hormones we hear so much. Adrenaline gives you instant energy. Cortisol gives you short-term energy. And when you exercise, you actually damage your muscles. Your muscles don't grow unless you get out of your comfort zone a little bit and get these little micro tears. And that's what triggers growth. So again, stress, it would seem like you'd think that any kind of injury to your muscles is bad for you, but in fact, it isn't. So another example of how stress really is good for you. And then renewal, when you get your rest and protein and when you connect with people, animals and so forth, your body produces these other hormones like oxytocin, which you may have heard of. It's been very much in vogue for the last 10 or 15 years, sometimes called the cuddle hormone or the love hormone. It's not quite that simple, but it does heal a lot of the kinds of damage that happen because of these other things. So adrenaline literally injures your heart muscle. It can, if you get enough. Oxytocin literally repairs that heart muscle. But it's even more interesting than that, because when we're stressed, we also tend to damage relationships. Oxytocin has an effect on our brain that drives us to repair those relationships and to connect more with other people. So not just cellular damage, but social damage as well. And then all the androgens, so things like human growth hormone and DHEA, those are things that actually don't just heal, but lead to growth. So there are these mental effects as well. Stress zeroes us in on the short term. We tend to take shortcuts and things that, you know, even might not be ethical under normal circumstances. And we tend to think of things very black and white, this or that. And we tend to be almost too realistic and lose optimism. And so we end up disconnecting from people, disconnecting from our values sometimes, as I was saying, and so forth. The mental effects of renewal are kind of the opposite of all that. You get the big picture back. You get your perspective back. Instead of adrenaline, cortisol giving you that immediate and short-term energy, now you're focused much more on the long-term and building up strength and resilience and so forth. And again, you become more flexible and you become more optimistic again. And I'll come back to realism and optimism, because resilient people are both realistic and optimistic, but we tend to go back and forth between the two. And renewal is all about reconnection. So actually I had nothing to do with the name of these webinars, but I love the fact that everybody's talked a bit about connection. So none of this is to say that stress can't hurt you. Again, it's like weightlifting. You lift too much, you lift too often, you don't get your rest and nutrition. Or kind of the last thing here is what we might call codependence, lifting other people's weights for them. Now you're not getting the stress you actually need, and they're not getting the stress they need, and you're getting too much stress. So those things certainly can hurt you. So I'm going to dive into each of these a little bit. So the physical part of this is about your own body and nature and so forth. That's the fight or flight response. So there's a little kitten who's ready to fight or fly. The renewal reaction, again, called rest and digest. Sharing meals together is an incredibly powerful way to activate renewal. There's some kind of almost magical things that happen when we make eye contact, when we swallow. Those things have very interesting effects on our nervous systems to help us connect and recognize who our friends are, feel bonded, feel supported, know that we're not alone. But that leads more into social. So the social stress reaction is actually to disconnect a bit, to become more defensive, to become distant. So think about any time you've maybe felt a little embarrassment. That's that social stress response of sort of, I want to back off. I'd like to be somewhere else other than dealing with this. And then the renewal reaction is called tend and befriend. And that actually is associated with oxytocin. Oxytocin makes us tend and befriend and care for others, people, dogs, horses, gardens, and so forth, more and more, and we reconnect. So those kind of activities are really important to do following any kind of natural disaster, including an earthquake. And then spiritual. Now, when I say spiritual, I don't necessarily mean religion. Religion can be a source of this, but it's the idea that you have a strong sense of purpose for your life. And when that stress reaction happens, our spiritual response is to become more selfish and survivalist. And something I want to point out here again is all of these stress reactions serve really good purposes. It was appropriate to do some stocking up of supplies and so forth when COVID-19 hit, for example. It is absolutely appropriate to stock up on, you know, a reasonable amount of supplies to be prepared for an earthquake, because you're not going to, you know, you may have a lot of trouble getting that afterwards. We have seen people who take that to extremes, and that is not necessarily so good. But again, all these stress responses serve very good purposes. And then the spiritual renewal reaction is to pause and plan. Again, get your perspective back. It can, we teach firefighters this all the time, because as we respond to an emergency, it's really easy to get so caught up in just reacting to what's happening that we actually can make mistakes if we don't stop, sort of step back, look at the big picture and say, are my priorities still correct? So again, this is something very important to do in the aftermath of an earthquake, or even, you know, as we heard earlier, just deciding whether your house is safe to occupy. If you only look at a tiny bit of it, you may not see the bigger picture. If you stand back, I teach CERT for San Jose and Milpitas and some other cities, and we tell people, stand back and look at the building, and are the angles still 90 degrees? And if they're not, you probably don't belong in that building. But pause and plan, stand back and look, get that perspective back. Here's one of the big mistakes we make, though, about trying to be resilient. Resilient people have a lot more motivation, they have more self-discipline, but those are the results of doing these things, not how you get there. So practicing all these renewal things that I'm alluding to, no time to go into them in detail, those will give you more motivation and self-discipline, but that can never be your starting point. So what am I talking about? Activating physical stress and renewal. So doing things like controlled breathing, really super powerful. Yoga, Pilates, and so forth. You might have noticed the picture in there of the firefighters doing yoga. That's getting to be more and more popular in the business of firefighting, because yoga really has both physical and mental effects that really activate renewal. Managing your stuff, having too many things or too few, both of those can be stressful. I could talk about diet a lot, but the best summary I have seen, just go into Google or your favorite search engine and search for anti-inflammatory diet. Every day, it seems like we're seeing new articles that open our eyes about the incredibly important relationship between our gut and our brain. Turns out our gut has a whole bunch of nerve cells. They're calling it our second brain now. And the biggest nerve in your body, the vagus nerve, connects your gut and your brain. So what you eat has a great deal to do with how resilient you are, your health, and so forth. After a disaster like an earthquake, a lot of times we end up getting a lot of kind of junk food. You should see the pile of high calorie stuff I bring home from fires, because I don't eat my whole lunch. Have to eat that very slowly over the year until the next fire season happens. Connecting with nature, super powerful. More and more studies, more and more doctors are now prescribing getting out into nature. Nobody really is absolutely sure why it's so powerful, but part of it may be simply that it doesn't require any maintenance. You know, nature takes care of itself. You don't have to vacuum, you don't have to dust, you don't have to sweep. It just takes care of itself. And sleep, 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 sleep. The more I've learned about sleep, the more I realize here's a very simple thing. After I read a great new book called Why We Sleep by Matthew, and I can't think of his last name, but Why We Sleep, I just became convinced that if everybody in this country would get enough sleep, a lot of our problems would go away, both behavioral problems, physical health problems, and so forth. Sleep is super important. And then, so the social, Mark, I see your message and I'll do my best. The social side of this is about, when psychologists study social support, they find that it correlates to our resilience better than anything else. So caring creates resilience. So we need to be vulnerable. We need to we all need people in our lives who get to see us for who we really are and who let us see them for who they really are. And that really helps us, gives us strength for both our ability to think clearly and manage our emotions and so forth, self-regulation. So that may, you may realize that implies that we actually need some social stress in our lives. We do need to be with people where we disclose things about ourselves that may, you know, will make us feel kind of uncomfortable. But somehow that tells our brain that a community has our back. And there's really almost nothing more important to that monkey mind than knowing that a community has your back. And so webinars like this are great just as a reminder that there are people who are thinking about these things and being ready and so forth. And the converse of it is there's almost nothing worse than thinking I'm the only one. I don't have a community behind me. So I do urge people to get out of their comfort zone a little in all these dimensions, physical, social, and then the spiritual one. Sorry about rushing a little but we are a little behind schedule, but animals are part of that too. Social support includes animals. The most amazing thing I get paid to do is taking crisis response dogs out to fires to visit firefighters and the community with CAL FIRE. Horses and dogs are particularly good. And we do have that parrot in the lower right, and just caring for her is probably good too. So then spiritual resilience, I already described it, that gives us strength for knowing our priorities and purpose. So again, it's important to step back, look at your priorities, have that sense of purpose, know why you do what you do. And a sense of wonder and awe also really contributes to that. One of my most amazing experiences the last few years was going up to Oregon to see the total eclipse of the sun. I was astonished at my own reaction to realizing the scale and just the, again, wonder and awe. So how do you do these things? Well, the big thing is start small and start over. Give yourself unlimited permission to fail and begin again, just like going to the gym, which is part of this, right? We tend to be really hard on ourselves, much more than we are hard on other people, but try to be as kind to yourself, as gentle with yourself as you are with other people. The shoulds are a giant red flag. There are, rather than focusing on what you should and should not do, turn them into the positives, the way you see here. And these slides will be available for you to read. So it's all about, again, resilient people are realistic optimists, but we tend to sort of go back and forth as disasters happen. So there's pre-disaster. Now, pre-disaster for an earthquake, you know, we might get a minute or two warning, but then it hits. And when it hits, we become extremely realistic. And then there's this phase we call, and communities go through these stages. There's a phase called heroic. So the public safety comes in, the Red Cross comes in, and it just seems like everything is going to be okay really fast because all the heroes have showed up. And then the whole community tends to get behind that. And then you're in the honeymoon phase where it just seems like everything's going to get rebuilt and fixed and so forth, and things will be better than they ever were before. But that always gives way to this phase called disillusionment. So in the weeks, months after any disaster, including earthquakes, it is natural to go through a period where the optimism evaporates, and you're just the reality of the disaster and how long it takes to recover just sinks in, and it's tough. And then reconstruction eventually happens. It can take a long time, and then we sort of get back, into that balance of realism and optimism. So if you want rocket fuel, sort of final thought here, rocket fuel for resilience and so forth, practice gratitude and generosity. Those things really build up your optimism, and they get your brain out of that negative default mode. So as I mentioned, got to pitch the books a little bit. I do have this book, Resilience During the Pandemic. It's on Amazon, gets fabulous reviews. And then the red one in the middle, that's more for people who are doing crisis intervention and so forth. And then next year, coming out from HarperCollins Leadership, that won't be out till July, unfortunately. Big publishers take a long time. Stress into Strength will be out. And that's this was a little bit of what will be in there. And then I'm going to post a few links if you want. Whoops. Well, I will in a moment post a few links, but that is my presentation.
Nick, thank you very much for your really fantastic overview of that you provided to us all. And yes, the as with the entire presentation, will be available in the recording, and the slides will be in the on the website too for you to download. And thanks for the comments from those of you who have appreciated this type of presentation that, you know, may be relevant not just for earthquakes, but for many things that we're dealing with right now. And I want to open it up for Sharon. Are there any questions for Nick?
No, there are not.
Good. And we have some previous questions I can see too. There was a question, please repeat the link for setting up a contact list. And I think that may have been back to Candace. What was that part of?
That was for Candace.
Yes. So it is at redcross.org. And what you'll search for is the Safe and Well program. Just a caution is it doesn't get activated until there is a natural disaster. So if you go there now, it'll tell you all about it, but you won't be able to, there's no disaster here locally.
So you don't set up the contact list until it's...
until there is a disaster, right?
I see Gloria's question, and the answer is yes. And let me just, I'll put my email address in here if anybody wants to get
a hold. The question is if Nick's available for other presenters, the presentations. And I would just like to add that, you know, this was, as we get some more questions coming in, this was the last of our 7 Steps Earthquake Safety Safer at Home webinar series. All of the recordings from the previous webinars are now online at earthquakecountry.org/safer-at-home, as this one will be by early next week. We're adding English and Spanish captions to all of them. I think we have Spanish on up through step 4, and the translations are still underway. We need to get them on. That will be available too. And there will be a survey link that will pop up as the webinar here ends on your web browser. If you could please complete that survey, take a moment right now. It's not that long. If you can't do it now, it will also be on the website, and we'll be sending an email to you about it. If you have any other questions or requests, you can email us at, I'm sharing the wrong slide here. Let me just fix that for a second. Not that it was so bad, you're just seeing the notes. There we go. info@earthquakecountry.org is where you can see the or send any questions you have. And any other questions, Sharon?
I'm sorry, I was muted. Just a compliment from John. Excellent presentation, Nick. So valuable. Thank you.
Thanks. You know, I'm looking back. There was a question earlier about help for renters, and I will say from my experience with VOED and so forth that there usually is. Every disaster is a little different. It kind of depends on whether it's local, state, federal, how much and what's available. So I guess the correct answer is it depends.
And if that was a question that came in during the insurance topic, maybe too, there is earthquake insurance for renters. It's actually quite reasonable, both from the California Earthquake Authority and other places too. So to insure your belongings, and it can also provide funding if you include the coverage for being out of your apartment and needing to live somewhere else for a while. So you can look into that. Okay, so just to, again, thank everybody for joining us today. And if you've joined us in our other webinars, really appreciate your participation. And please complete the survey. With that, everybody, have a great rest of your day.